that's it. Okay. What an introduction. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to talk about fetishism in Norwegian politics and the role it has played in the erasure of women's rights. So I made this presentation with Christina Ellingsen, the spokeswoman of Lydia Norway, which is not here today, but I guess she's watching. What we were presented at the Motivation for Trans Activism in Norway, it began within the year 2000, where Rikshospitalet, which is like the gender clinic in Norway, ends the gender correction treatment for transsexualism. And same year, Tom Børje Hansen, transsexual man, established Harry Benjamin Resource Center. This Tom Børje Hansen, transsexual man, established Harry Benjamin Resource Center. And the goal was to reopen the Rikshospitalet's gender correction treatment for transsexualism. And then we were talking about the little minority people. Where are we today? How has it developed? Meet Jørund Tore Alme. The Nøller Bad manager has two healthy legs that now lives a life as a woman in a wheelchair in the financial environment in Oslo. Because he has always wanted to be in a wheelchair, so he identifies that his legs are not functional. He's married and has two children with his wife, Agnes. When he decided to order a wheelchair, his wife wondered if it was something sexual, perhaps a fetish. I don't know, maybe, answered Jørund. When he started ordering women's shoes online as well, his wife, Agnes, again asked Jørund if he had tried on her dresses too. Yes, I have, answered Jørund. And these two were interviewed on Norwegian television, and they presented them as very brave and stunning.
Oh, yes.
And here we have John Jeanette Solstad Remy, 74 now, the transvestite and former submarine captain from the military. He has fought a long battle and to be a woman paper and a man between his legs.
Yes.
In 2010, as a 60-year-old, he could finally come out as his authentic self, publicly. He dressed up like a woman when he was a teenager, he says, and he also says the urge to dress in women's clothes were uncontrollable. John Jeanette has fought, In 2014, he fronted Amnesty Norway's signature campaign to get the Minister of Health, gay man called Bent Høie, to remove the diagnostic criteria for changing legal gender. John Jeanette fronted the campaign to be able to change the legal sex himself. In 2015, he appeared in a weekly magazine where he told how it has been like to live a long life as a transvestite. He's married and has two children. Yeah, and here we have the statement from the John Jeanette. And then we go to Espen Pirelli Benestad, the former professor who considered trans people as indigenous people without a country. He's notorious, specialized in the construction of the transgender joint. To paraphrase Heather Rensselaer Clemens and Michelle Moore. And here you see a screenshot from a program called Did You Know That There Were Seven Sexes at the Norwegian Broadcasting TV? This was actually shown for on a channel called NRK Super for children between 2 and 12 years. And here he explains his understanding of what the eunuch is, what the woman is, what the man is, what the gender filter is, what intersex is, what asexual and trans is. And Benestad's son, he's a filmmaker, and he made a really good documentary about his father, Benestad, which is called Everything About My Father. And here Benestad says, in adult, can somebody explain that word for me? Adolescence?
It became very erotic and humanistic to be a woman or to dressing like a woman. And in 2017, Benstein and his spouse and co-professor Elsa Almås, founder of the Norwegian Association for Clinical Sexuality, co-authored an article in the Journal of Sexual Medicine titled Autogynephilia and Autoandrophilia Revisited, which argues that the sexual arousal men experience through transgenic cross-dressing should be normalized and interpreted not as an underlying paraphilia that is the primary motivation for becoming a woman man, but as a learned erotic variation that is natural in the persons who are attracted to women men and the persons experience the erotic qualities of men garments. And this sort of different relics who has done a brilliant job on journalism on this. Benestad advocates for normalizing sexual fetishes and is largely credited with introducing the concept gender euphoria as a euphemism to the sexual excitement. This screenshot is from Benestad at the program called Talk, where he misinformed about the joy people who have gotten treatment for their gender dysphoria, how happy they are, and other different wrongs that he's actually saying on the television. Next please. Here he is presented as a male because here he's in Pride and it's in a magazine for medicine. So that's how he looks when he dresses like a male. And these men that I have shown now, they are men whose gentrification of women are so extreme that they attempt to embody it. Everyone that they meet are covertly coerced to participate in what is explicitly expressed by themselves to be a sexual fetish. So now I'm going to talk a little, show a little bit about the Norwegian Fetish Lobby, BY65, and the depathologization of BDSM and transvestite fetishism. This is 3Y65, which is BDSM activist behind the want of Rachel, decision to remove transvestite fetishism and sadomasochism from psychiatric diagnosis. The pathologization of transvestite fetishism was a sanitizing step that removed stigma and created a protective distance between the reality of sexually motivated fetishism and the claimed asexual neutral motivation of the right to be one's authentic self. Revive 65 was behind the campaign to depathologize BDSM and transvestite fetishism in 2010. The campaign succeeded in removing transvestite fetishism from Norwegian healthcare legislation. In 2019, Revive65 returned as part of the queer organization with a man called Marius as the new director. This time, the aim is to remove the stigma surrounding BDSM. So, in pink dress here, you have the former Prime Minister of Norway. And she is predicted in 2020. It's Anne Solberg, and she hands over an award, an honor to Fetish BDSM Club. And as she said, everybody should be able to be themselves. And you see the fetish gear behind here. And in 2024, the Pride Month, the director of BDSM Club in Oslo, also Marius, who is a homosexual man, he was on the NRK Norwegian Broadcasting News in his fetish gear, talking about pride and the importance of the important role BDSM gay men has had in the development of pride. So this was like dinner time, Saturday nights, when the whole family is in front of TV.
Oh, wow.
And then just some days later, the same director, that is like we are visiting the BDSM club. And we are looking at the instruments and things they have in their exciting cellar. And we have sleeves in the basement, which is like ergonomically correct position for anal sex, fist fucking, and other things. This was also in the dinner time when the whole family is gathered in front of the TV. So it's like it's just normal. And here he talks about this is the kind of grooming of young people. When he like say, I wish when I was young that it was like a shameless guy like me, who were like proud in pride wearing his fetish gear like this. So summary of key points: irrefutable evidence of explicit fetishistic movement. Motivation at the foundation of trans activism, successful penetration and distancing between fetishistic motivation and claimed motivation via categorization, the exploitative and misogynistic nature of gay men's politics, because this would not be possible in Norway without the gay man in both politics and organizations and media. And in the hands of the gay transsexual men, the definition of women have changed into a perverted definition where women are reduced to an idea of a fetish men can wear or declare to be, and the normalization of BDSM. Part four, very short part. I've been part of the lesbian and gay seen since I was 16, so I really experienced the misogynistic or the way these homosexuals in these how they perceive women and how they talk about women. They always said women are like lesbians are ugly, women smell, and all these things. And for lesbians to be organized together with homosexual men has no benefit lesbians, but I call it the pair patriarchy because it's a functional minority. And everybody knows, so the adult men are abusing also the younger men coming into town, but we are not allowed to talk about it because it's then the world can go against us. So they are protecting the abusive men and not the young gay men. And homosexual men are in charge, and the agenda is access to children and women's bodies. And we have the excellent talk about that here. It's the legalization of surrogacy, it's porn prostitution, it's the fantasy, trans child, and it's fetishism. And then we also have the attitude in homosexual culture with fag heads, which is like a real slur, which they call women who are like handmaidens for them. They are applauding everything they do, looking, laughing when they're trying to be funny. And it's like the gay men, they are like spitting on the floor when they are leaving because they really can't. Huge content for these women. And part four, how does this affect women? Just for the other thing, I think we need to talk about how homosexuals, the way they look at women, that is something we do not talk so much about, but we need to talk about it because it's important and a part of why this whole thing has been so successful. As Joan said in her excellent speak, they are especially targeting radical feminism and radical feminists because we know they are weakening and destroying girls' and women's basic instincts, instincts we need to trust and understand to understand and recognize abusive behavior and to protect and take care of ourselves. And I think Sheila Jeffrey spoke brilliantly on this earlier today. I hope I can get your speak. I saw it was on paper, so I can memorize it or something, because the whole normalization of this fetishism is harmful to women and children, and women are protecting children. So it is a dehumanization of women, and the view of women are shaped by poor fetishization, fetishism, prostitution.
As well, sorry.
Traffic, violence, and abuse, and humiliation, which is what, and this humiliation is what fetishism is really about. What we see now, all these pictures are normal to for people in Norway to see. They are presented as everything is normal with these men and their fetish gear. Politicians, we have a lesbian minister of culture. We asked her a question, can you please answer the question, do lesbians have penis? And she said, I don't like the premise of the questions, because gender identity is also sex. So she couldn't answer that. And now in Pride, we have a new minister of culture, and she was giving the Pride the best can have. In response to that, she did something really terrible that shows how unconsciousness and little people in power know about this. Could you please play it? So she can stand you, and then she does this. And this is the Minister of Culture in Norway. And then it's the gay man applauding, because they can have just this. So it's really shocking. This next is the last one, I think. It's shocking, yeah. And I think every time she will participate somewhere, some students will take off their phone and watch this.
Yeah.
And watch this sequence. And for young girls, it's like to see, I mean, to do this, it's really horrible. There is a new perception of girls, women in the world that make this fetishism possible. And women, as a sex class, are not educated to protect women's rights and dignity, which is what we are trying to do here. Because this would not be possible if we have had the knowledge and the tools to protect ourselves from misogynistic things like transgenderism and things like this. And it's a really hard learning lesson to experience that women as a group to be self-destructive. And also when we see all this, what I also notice is like women feel really guilty on men talking about their shame of sexuality and everything. So we want to help. And by helping, they feel strong, but they are really, what they are really doing is like destroying the rights that the women before we fought for. So I think these conferences and these fantastic talks in these rooms, we are going to take the opportunity to do something about it. And the education radical feminists can offer is really necessary. So that's why we are here, and that was that.